Mr. President, I
came to the floor to talk about other matters, and I will get to those in a moment, but I can't help but be struck by the Democratic leader's sudden interest in addressing health care reform. It is a fact that even if Hillary Clinton were elected president of the United States, we would be revisiting the failed promises of the Affordable Care Act. Premiums, for example, since 2013 have gone up 105% in the individual market. That is, people who don't have employer-provided coverage or aren't on Medicare or Medicaid, people, small businesses, individuals have to go out and purchase their health care, have seen premiums go up 105%. And we hear stories every day, and I'll recount some of those from Texas, where people say they have zero choices. For example, in Iowa, we learned that there are no insurance companies that are willing to sell health insurance on the individual market. That isn't because of anything that President Trump or the Republican majority has done. These are the failures of Obamacare, which President Obama made extravagant promises about Obamacare, none of which has really proven to be true. He said you'd bring down premiums to $2,500 for a family of four. Well, these folks in the individual market have seen their premiums go up 105% since 2013. He said if you like your policy, you can keep your policy. Well, that proved not to be true, because unless you bought the government-approved health care policy, insurance companies couldn't sell it on the exchanges. And he said, if you like your doctor, you can keep your doctor. But as people find out when their policies change, frequently the doctors in the network that they can see change. And so people saw premiums go up, they lost coverage they liked, and they lost the doctor that they had confidence in. So the suggestion of the Democratic leader that somehow this current situation is a result of President Trump or congressional action is ludicrous. And I think people understand that, but I just couldn't resist responding a little bit to what he had to say, because sometimes when people don't respond, they assume there isn't a response, and clearly there is. Mr. President, it's good to be back at work here in Washington after a work week at home, and I had the honor, starting on Memorial Day, of spending some time with Texas's newest recruits to our country's military academies. Every year, now for the 11th year, I've had the privilege of hosting an academy send-off ceremony in Military City, USA, my hometown of San Antonio. This annual gathering recognizes the bright young Texans who've accepted an appointment to one of the premier military academies that serve our armed forces. And I'm always proud to celebrate the incredible achievements they've made so far in their young lives and encourage them as they begin a life of public service. It is truly inspirational, and it is my favorite event of the year. This year, about 272 young Texans have answered the call to get a service academy education and then a career of military service. It's a good deal if you can qualify for it, because you basically get a free ride to one of these premier service academies. Plus, we train the next generation of military leaders, which is good for all of us. As I said, my wife Sandy and I look forward to this event each year, and we found that Memorial Day is a fitting time to send off these young men and women while we at the same time remember the ultimate sacrifice made by those who gave their lives answering that same call to service. I try to recruit a top-tier speaker to these events, somebody who will challenge and inspire these young men and women, and this year was no exception. Admiral William McRaven, the Chancellor of the University of Texas System, spoke to these incoming cadets and midshipmen about lessons he learned in public service and his 37 years in the United States Navy as a Navy SEAL. He spoke candidly that this would be the greatest challenge of their young lives, but also the most rewarding. And he said it would be a decision they would never regret. And he also spent some time, appropriately so, on Memorial Day, talking about the heroes who have sacrificed all to serve the military of the greatest country in the world. So all in all, Memorial Day was a was a great day, and it was a great event for these young men and women. As we come back the week after Memorial Day, I know I'm not the only one encouraged by their example to find better ways, more effective ways to serve our country. And fortunately, this chamber, the United States Senate, will have a chance to do that. Soon we'll vote on a bill that will reform the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs, a department riddled with inefficiencies and marked too often by scandal and corruption. This is a huge government department. Last count, some 330,000 people work for the Veterans Administration. And unfortunately, we've all become familiar with the horror stories of fake scheduling, indicating that people actually were being seen who were not seen, huge wait times, and people literally dying as a result of not getting the treatment that they've earned by virtue of their military service through the Department of Veterans Affairs. This legislation that we will vote on is called the Department of Veterans Affairs Accountability and Whistleblower Protection Act. It'll protect those Veterans Administration employees who care deeply for veterans by protecting them as whistleblowers. And it also provides managers with the tools they need to address poor performance and misconduct. To sum it up, this bill will make it easier for VA employees to be held accountable, and that's something that the Veterans Administration and our veterans desperately need, as it has for some time. It'll make the VA work better for the men and women who have served us so well. I should point out that at a time when I suspect people doubt whether there is any bipartisanship in the United States Congress or in Washington, that this is a bipartisan piece of legislation. It was voted out of the Veterans Affairs Committee by voice vote 2 weeks ago, which essentially is by unanimous consent. And it has growing support among groups focused on helping our returning warriors to get the treatment and care and support they need. And that's because the bill will help the VA to do what it's supposed to do, and which it unfortunately hasn't always done well, which is to serve our veterans. Like all of us, I have the honor of meeting with our veterans regularly and working with them to help them succeed after giving so much of themselves to keep our country safe. One other example of legislation, bipartisan legislation, that was signed last week by the President of the United States was a bill called the American Law Enforcement Heroes Act, a bill that I introduced to help connect veterans to opportunities in law enforcement in their local communities. So it's another example, perhaps not in a headline, as not a big partisan food fight over it, so maybe most people aren't aware of it, but I think it's important to remind people that amid all the distractions that they see in Washington and in the news, that there is work, important work, being done to benefit people who certainly deserve it, and that would be the case for our veterans. I'm thankful for the work of the chairman of the Senate Veterans Affairs Committee, Senator Isaacson, as well as the diligent, thoughtful work of the junior senator from Florida, Senator Rubio, on this important veterans bill. So I look forward to passing this bill soon. I also look forward tomorrow to confirming the nominee, or perhaps it's this afternoon, confirming the nominee for general counsel of the Central Intelligence Agency. Director Pompeo has been there for some time now, having been nominated by President Trump and confirmed, an outstanding choice to be the director of the Central Intelligence Agency. But like every organization, it seems these days, the CIA needs a good lawyer to lead its efforts to make sure that it conducts itself precisely in accordance with the rule of law. And Ms. Elwood is extraordinarily qualified. She served during the administration of President George W. Bush as a counselor to the Attorney General, deputy counsel to the Vice President, and associate counsel to the President. And I'm confident that she'll serve with a sharp, independent mind at the CIA, and I hope we'll confirm Courtney Elwood soon, and I trust we will. Finally, Mr. President, as we redouble our work on the failed Obamacare law and seek to replace it with market-driven solutions so people can actually buy insurance they want at a price they can afford, I want to briefly remind my colleagues why we're fixing it. I alluded to that at the beginning, and now I'll close with a few more reminders. Just last week, it was reported that only three insurance companies who offer plans on the Obamacare exchanges will return to the Houston area in 2018. In 2016, just last year, there was more than twice that number, and so we can see the pool of available choices for Americans on the exchanges has shrunk and continues to shrink, and in places like Iowa has gone away entirely, where there is no insurance company willing to sell insurance on the Obamacare exchanges. Houston, after all, is the nation's fourth most populous city. So if you're seeing that sort of trend there, it can and it will happen everywhere. Obamacare continues to fail the American people by not delivering on its promises. I've said before that in my previous life, I was Attorney General of the state of Texas. One of the most important things the Attorney General's office does is consumer protection, protecting consumers from fraudsters and those who would try to deceive them and cheat them out of their hard-earned money. And I've said, because I believe it to be true, that Obamacare represents one of the largest cases of consumer fraud that I have ever seen. When President Obama made the extravagant promises he made, and yet we have the evidence of its failure, it's clear that the American people were misled when it came to Obamacare. So many people aren't getting the access to health care they thought, and those who are using Obamacare exchanges are finding it's increasingly expensive. Their premium, as I indicated, had gone up 105% in the 39 states with Obamacare exchanges since 2013 alone. And then the deductibles that most people find, their out-of-pocket costs before the insurance actually kicks in, keeps going up and up and up, to the effect that many people essentially find themselves without the benefit of the insurance that they're paying so much for because the deductible is so high. We know that the insurers on the exchanges just keep passing the costs on to the customer, with rate increases up almost 50% in many cases, and that's just in the Houston area I'm talking about. Obviously, the 105% since 2015 is a nationwide number. We know that nationwide as well, that only one in three counties has only one insurer on the Obamacare exchange as of 2017. This is just simply unsustainable, and it's irresponsible. That's why my colleagues and I are committed to doing something about it. Our friend, the Democratic leader, was in here claiming that the instability in the market and the fact that premiums are so high and insurance companies are leaving as a result of instability created by political uncertainty now. Well, that's clearly not the case. Obamacare has been with us since 2016, and it's been a terrible failure to the people who buy their insurance on the individual market. That's why we're committed to doing everything we can to replacing it with patient-centered options that actually work, that help people get the type of coverage they want at a price they can afford.